Greetings across whatever you watch stuff on. This is the Silent Comedy Watch Party. Glad we could come over to your place, or you over to ours. I'm Ben Modell, one of your hosts. This is a live streamed show that is sent from our homes to yours, or wherever you're watching this, to bring some laughs to you at the end of or at the start of the week. We always go live a few minutes ahead of time so that we know our equipment's up and running. And as anyone who watched last time knows, we need to make sure our equipment is up and running.
Yay!
And which it seems to be, but you still have a little time.
Yes! And if you're joining us from the east coast of the U.S. or Canada, where we are, you still have a little time to microwave some popcorn. If you are on the west coast of Canada and the U.S., perhaps you're making a little lunch or brunch to enjoy while you watch the show today. If you're our friends in Europe and Scandinavia, perhaps you're making a nightcap or a little cup of hot tea on a cold winter night to share with us today. And to all of our friends all over the world, welcome. We cannot wait to laugh with you today.
Thank you, Mana. Thank you very much. So we will start in a few minutes while you're waiting here. Is an interlude created as soon as I put my hands on the keys just for you. Happy Sunday, everybody.
Happy February.
Oh, gosh, it's February.
It's February.
It's February 6th. We've got, what, 22 days to learn how to pronounce February properly. Thanks for watching. Thanks for being here today. Oh, there it is. Here we go. I'm Ben Modell. I'm a silent film accompanist, historian, presenter, and we're so glad to be here with you today for episode 76 of the Silent Comedy Woo-hoo! Watch Party. Hi.
Hi.
I have to remember to do this. Good to see you. Thanks for having us over for some funny old movies. This is a live stream show. This is really happening right now, unless you're watching this after now. But for those of you watching us as we live stream from our homes to yours, thanks for having us over. And just so you know, this is really happening from our living room. I'm here as I am at every show with my wife, Mona Allen.
Hi, our camera guys. Lights and everything. Welcome back.
Thank you very much, Mona. I'll be joined momentarily by co-host Steve Massa, who is safely ensconced on the other side of Central Park with his wife, Susan. And they'll be joining us in a little bit. So, and we want to thank Steve and also Susan co-pilots the show with Mona. Yes, via text.
Thank you, Susan.
And boy, for those of you who were with us for episode 75, there was a lot of texting.
Text
between you and Leonard and Susan, and it was quite something. So
exciting.
We've recovered, and we want to thank also our associate producer Crystal Kai.
Thank you, Crystal.
For all she does behind the scenes, keeping things on task and on track, and of course Marlene Weissman, who does our graphics, our logo, and our triptych every week. So thank you, Marlene. So we're glad you're here for episode 76. We've got a great program. Thank you for watching. Thank you for posting comments, whether you sent in emails or on Twitter, or for those of you who posted comments on the YouTube link for this show. It's fun not just for us because we don't get to see you after the show like I do at an in-person program, but for other viewers. It's fun, especially if you list where you're watching from. Even if all you do is post a comment and say, "Hi, I'm watching from Pawtucket," or wherever it is you are, it gives all, because you can't look around the auditorium and say, "Oh, there's that guy again," or "Oh, I think I remember him from." So this is our way of building our sense of being all part of a virtual cinema audience together.
Yes, a community.
Yes, exactly. So, and for those of you who have sent in a contribution to support the shows, we really appreciate that. That's not why we're doing this, but if you're so moved and so able, we are set up for that on Square, PayPal, Venmo, et cetera, and the information about sending in a donation to help support the shows is on the Silent Comedy Watch Party page and in the description in the YouTube link. So thank you. Thank you very much. We are a month away from our second anniversary show.
Wow.
So just to let you know, we'll do one more live stream show this month, February, and then we'll be back on March 13th for our, yeah, that's it, which is it's the second anniversary of our first episode, of the pilot. So, and we'll explain why we're adjusting the date a little bit next time. But we're so glad you're here. We've got a great program, and I'm going to take the button that says Steve off and hit the button that turns Steve on. We'll say hello to Steve Massa, everybody. Hello.
Hey,
hi, Steve.
Hello.
Yay. Yeah, hi.
Hey, happy Sunday.
Yeah. Yeah, good to see you, Steve.
Well, you too, Ben, Mona.
Yes.
Every day.
Yeah. Yeah. Steve and I saw each other in person because we did a program at the Museum of Modern Art last Sunday of Edward Everett Horton comedies.
Great.
Yeah.
It went well, actually.
It went really well, and it was fun because it was the second time we've been able to show these films to an audience that we were at.
Yeah, that we got to hear the live audience. Yeah.
You guys were great, and it was so fun for me to meet some of our watch party friends.
Right. There were some people who said, "Please tell Mona." I said, "She's over there," and then they recognized her voice because she was talking to something. But it was, but there were a lot of folks who, from the New York area, who are comfortable coming to an in-cinema event, and it was great to see everybody. But we've got a great program. We have, this is one of our 2 one-reelers and 1 two-reeler show. And so I've got everything thrown up. I'm looking over at my monitor and everything is behaving itself so far.
Oh, good.
So quick, while the digital gremlins are taking a nap, Steve, would you tell everybody a little bit about Dodge Your Debts?
Yes. Okay. Well, we've got Dodge Your Debts. This is a 1921 Hal Roach produced comedy. And it stars a Lloyd, but not necessarily the Lloyd you expect when you hear the name Hal Roach. Here's an ad for this new series. It says, a new comedian with a famous name, and that's Lloyd. Well, it was Harold's older brother, Gaylord. And Hal Roach got the idea to revive the Lonesome Luke character, which Harold stopped using in 1917. I guess Roach thought there was a little more money to be made on Lonesome Luke. So he decided to revive the character with Gaylord. Now, Gaylord, he was Harold's older brother. He was 5 years older. And it was really because of Gaylord that Harold first started his stage career. Here he is from in the one outfit we're going to see today in Dodge Your Debts, and the other shot on the golf course is from another one called A Zero Hero, which does exist. Gaylord worked backstage, and they were living in Nebraska, I think, at the time, and he worked backstage at the local theater, and they needed a child or a young kid to be in. They were doing a production of Shakespeare's Scottish play, and I'm not going to say the title because it's supposed to be bad luck, but
right.
thank you, Steve.
You know,
thank
the you. One with the Scottish play with the lady Scottish name, and you know, famous. Anyway,
yeah.
They needed a
kid. Yeah. Yes, yes.
Yeah. I don't want to spit and turn around 3 times and everything.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's the one that Denzel is in movies right now.
Yeah, yeah. With Coen Brothers directed.
Yeah.
So anyway, they needed a kid, and Gaylord recommended Harold, and that was Harold's first experience on stage, and he was hooked, and he became, you know, he decided he wanted to be an actor. And so Gaylord had worked behind the stage in theater, but when Harold ended up out in L.A., Gaylord was there as well, and they were all living with their father. The three of them were living together in one room, scraping pennies. And Harold, you know, started in movies as an extra. And as soon as Hal Roach set up his own company in 1914 and started using Harold as one of the main stars, Gaylord was in the films. He's in the 1915, the earliest surviving Roach comedy, Just Nuts, from 1915. And Gaylord turns up as a waiter in a cabaret. So he was right from the beginning, always doing bits and assistant directing and props and whatever needed to be done. So, you know, Roach knew Gaylord well, and so they decided to create this series. And you can really see the difference. I mean, the films are very well made. They have great gags. They're constructed and everything by the regular Roach company. But Gaylord is fine. He can do a lot of the physical gags, but he just doesn't have whatever star quality that Harold had. He doesn't have that charisma. And, you know, it's kind of not his fault, but the series didn't last very long. They announced 26 and they made 5 of these. Mm-hmm. And but Gaylord continued after this series. He went back to working in Harold's films and was assistant director on The Kid Brother and Welcome Danger and part of Harold's company. And, you know, he worked for many years in films. Unfortunately, he actually had an accident that was similar to Harold's accident, where Harold lost his thumb and finger shooting the film Scarface. In 1921, there was an explosive cap went off too soon and hurt 8 actors, and one of them was Gaylord, and he lost an eye. He had a piece of copper go through his eye.
Oh, good heavens.
Yeah, so both of the Lloyd men, you know, Harold lost his thumb and finger, and Gaylord lost his eye thanks to the movie. But he worked for years. You'll see a lot of Hal Roach regulars. George Rowe has a very nice part, cross-eyed George Rowe, who was a Roach regular. The great big guy who plays Estelle Harrison's father is Roscoe Tiny Ward, who is in tons of films. And Estelle Harrison was sort of a second or third leading lady in the Harold Lloyd film. She's in starting with the Lonesome Luke films she's in, and they decided to give her the lead in this series. So I think we should go ahead and take a look, and then we can talk more specifics.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, about the people and where it was shot and that kind of thing afterward.
Okay, great. All right. Thank you. Thank you very much, Steve. So we want to thank David Callett and AllDay Entertainment.
Thank you, David.
For giving us the okay to stream for you this edition of the film, which can be found on American Slapstick 2, a multi-disc set. It may be out of print. Oh, I think it is out of print, but you can turn up copies on eBay and Amazon. It's just crammed full of great comedy shorts. And if you have a hard time finding a copy, drop me a line. I may be able to help you out. This film actually came, it was on there. It came to our attention because I've been in touch with somebody who had emailed me over my website, and I was asking about Gaylord Lloyd, and it turns out there's somebody who's a huge silent film and classic film fan who's in high school.
Wow.
Someone, a young person named Dakota, who was writing to me, and I thought, oh, we should show this because it turns out it's a fun short and not a lot of people have seen it. So thanks for the suggestion.
Thank you, Dakota.
Thank you so much. Okay, Manu, if you get the lights.
Okay. I can't wait to see this.
Yeah. This should be a lot of fun. Here is Dodge Your Debts, starring Gaylord Lloyd.
Thank you.
And that is the
ending.
Yes, yes, happy ending. That is Dodge Your Debts with Gaylord Lloyd and lots of other people.
Yeah, I've never seen a brick fight. I mean, I've never seen a full-on brick fight.
Brick fight, yeah. Well, this is one of the things I remember Steve and I were talking years ago to our friend Brent Walker, who's written the book on Max Zen, and I asked him, were there... Because we've always talked about the fact that everybody thinks that there's a lot of pie fights in Keystone films. He said, no, there's more bricks than anything. and you know, it's been in Keystone, and certainly here, there's just a lot of...
Oh, tons of bricks.
Just, yeah, lots of bricks.
They were supposedly made out of foam and everything. So
right, they, yeah. They bounce off people's faces, and then they spit out fake
like
teeth.
Real bricks.
Oh, no. But it was... No,
but
yeah.
It's interesting that they kind of set this in England. You know, and there's all the Cockney, the buskers, everybody in the buskers outfits.
Yeah, we're missing the, you know, this edition at the beginning. It says Pathograms, which was a 16mm home use or home movie company that would release a lot of these shorts. And so they don't, the original main title or title cards are missing. I know that some of the shorts that that have, from what I've seen from some of the Harold Lloyd comedies around this time or just before Grandma's Boy is there'll be a main title card, and then there's a cast card, and at the bottom of it is a two sentences setting up the rest of the story.
Oh,
you see that in and so it's entirely possible that there's a note at the very bottom of the cast list of the original cast title that says Jolly Old England, although that whole sequence with the trolley is a location that we've seen. All of a sudden, they time travel to Los Angeles.
You mean the bus? Yeah,
the bus.
The
yeah.
bus. Yeah, it's like totally in California.
Oh yeah, you know, all
with
of a sudden.
Trees on the either side. Yeah. And you know.
Yeah, definitely. So yeah.
But I do think for the stuff with the sets that they shot at Universal, because Universal used to rent out their standing sets, and they have an old limehouse.
Yeah.
Group of sets. So they probably, you know, rented that. And it looks like some of the sets from Lonesome Luke's Tin Can Alley, which we saw at MoMA. So they probably went back to the same location, you know, back to
Universal.
They
must have known about it. Yeah.
And also,
there's no other reason to set it in England except that, oh, there's a set we could have for a week or two.
But there's also the set that's in From Hand to Mouth with the swinging doors. And Gaylord goes in, and Ro goes underneath, and there's a long sequence in From Hand to Mouth.
Hand to Mouth, the Harold Lloyd comedy,
and the little girl, and they're popping in and out, and so that was the same location wherever that was, if it was Universal.
When they get on the double decker bus, I mean, I thought, didn't I see this sequence in one of the in Vacation Ways with Everett Horton lots of comedy shorts? Yes, Monica.
Never seen anyone slide down a banister.
Oh yeah, that's a good gag.
It's a good gag.
And Tiny Ward just happens to be on the bus for no particular
apparent reason.
Yeah, he's just sitting there on the top of the bus. So you know, it's just how do we fill this out?
We completely missed how he got to the U.S. and got on the bus and get onto the second.
Yeah.
That's the beauty of silent film and silent comedy films. You can make a jump like that. It's not really until afterwards you go, wait a second.
Right.
And then it doesn't really ruin the film either.
It doesn't matter. You know?
No, it doesn't really matter.
But, you know, Tiny Ward is a good point to talk about him. Yeah. He was a silent comedy regular. He started appearing in films in the late teens, and of course, his gigantic size, he was something like 6'7", 6'8", you know, pushing 7 feet. And so he was perfect to be in silent films, silent comedies. And he worked a lot for Max Sennett. He worked a lot for Roach. You know, the 20s were like his heyday. He was just working constantly. In the freshman, he's the big football player that's given Harold a lot of trouble. And he had been a university football player. Here he is strangling. Now, this fellow that he's strangling is the guy that they beat up in the bar and everything.
Yes, the first, the very British guy.
I'm very suspicious that it's Snub Pollard.
I was wondering the same thing. I was going to ask you.
It looked like Snub doing a cameo kind of in disguise.
Yeah.
But, you know, I guess there's no way we can know unless somebody finds an item. But I think he was just doing it, you know. And then the
face
fellow
and the physicality, it's very similar.
Yeah, especially the physicality. I really do think it was Snub. And he does kind of some Snub falls and kind of thing. Now, the fellow that's standing behind Tiny Ward is William Gillespie.
That is Gillespie, again.
Oh,
that's
Gillespie.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, and he's in like every Roach film made in the 1920s.
Yeah, if you don't see William Gillespie, you hope he was okay that week.
And he had a big part last week when we showed backstage. He was the guy who was running the troupe and getting the kids to do all that stuff. So he had a big part in that.
And we saw him on this past Sunday because he's in Horse Shy with Edward Everett Horton.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
He's just everywhere.
He was extremely prolific.
Yeah.
And, of course, George Rowe, we mentioned before, and he has a great part. And, you know, he's always funny. He's this kind of zany that just turns up all the time. And we've, those of us that try to fill in, you know, the silent comedy history and the history of these people, we haven't been able to find, he's still a man of mystery. We haven't been able to find out anything about him. Where he was from, was he from England? Was he, you know, from vaudeville? Was he really cross-eyed? He may not have been, that may have been just a shtick. And so he's in, starting in 1919, he's again, like Gillespie, turns up in just about every Roach film made. And then once in a while, you'll see him somewhere else. He's in a 1919 Henry Lehrman film called Punch of the Irish. Mm. And he has a large part. He's in a couple of Christie comedies later. And he leaves films like 1929. And then...
Yeah, I think, isn't your he has a short gag in Your Darn Tootin'?
Yes, and that's then, like the last, I think one of the last...
I think that's his last screen appearance, is Your Darn Tootin' with Laurel and Hardy.
And nobody knows, and it's funny, a friend of ours, Sam Gill, is a film historian, and Sam had been out in California since the 1960s, and was very friendly with supporting player Eddie Baker, who's the referee in City Lights, and we've seen him in a number of things.
Who kind of looks like Tiny Ward.
Yeah, except smaller, yeah. A little smaller.
Yeah, yeah.
But so Sam was hooking up with Eddie Baker, and Eddie said, oh, you'll never guess who I ran into on my way over here. I ran into George Rowe on the street. But he didn't get his phone number. He didn't get his address where he was living. So this was 1965, so Sam was trying to find him at that point, but he couldn't. There's like a million George Rowes. Like if right. you look, like Brent Walker and I looked through the Los Angeles phone books from the 20s, and we found a couple that list the profession as photo player. So we know that was that George Rowe, but we still, so we don't know. He's a man of mystery. Just like he is in the films, because he looks like he's from another planet. Like he's been dropped, he's been dropped into the activity, and he's just a complete zany. So
yeah, but he does get to more to do in this picture. Often he's just a punchline, and he's a supporting player in this.
Yeah, sometimes, you know, they like Paul Parrott and his girl go to get married, and he's the minister.
Right.
George Rowe's a minister with a sign that says his name is I.C. Crossed. Or something like that. So it's kind of a payoff kind of thing. Yeah. And now this film was directed by a director named Earl C. Kenton. Mm. And Kenton had started his career at Max Sennett as an actor, and he became an assistant director. And then he became a director, full-time director. And his only work at Roach were three shorts with Gaylord Lloyd. But he continued, he directed a lot of stuff in the 20s for Sennett. He was all over the place. But by the late 20s.
Definitely.
Yeah, he was directing features. He directed that film, I think he directed Bare Knees with, her name?
Virginia Corbin.
Yeah, Virginia Corbin.
Yeah.
But he directed features. So probably his most famous film is the 1932 Island of Lost Souls with Charles Laughton. This cult horror film, you know, it's a great film. But he directed You're Telling Me with W.C. Fields. And in the 40s, he was on contract to Universal. So he directed some of the first Abbott Costello films, like Pardon My Sarong. And he also directed some of their horror films. He directed The Ghost of Frankenstein with Lon Chaney Jr. and two of their monster rallies, House of Frankenstein and House of Dracula. And then in the 50s, he directed television. So he worked till about 1960, you know.
Wow.
So he was a, you know, real pro. Worked his way up from, you know, slapstick to... Yeah. Kind of a regular kind of studio director.
Yeah. Yeah.
But
it is a fun film, and like I mentioned before, it's on this DVD, American Slapstick 2.
But
yes.
We had
somebody else we had to mention?
Well, a couple other pictures.
I'm sorry. Yes, go ahead.
And some of these pictures are from Richard Simonton Jr.
Yeah.
Who was...
Oh, there's this one.
Here's another picture of Gaylord. And Richard sent me these photos a few days ago to use for the show. But Richard had worked with Harold Lloyd in restoring Harold's films and photographs. And he was also instrumental in saving the Edward Everett Horton shorts that Harold produced.
Yeah, more than he's crucial. Here's another image that he sent you.
Oh, yeah. So Richard sent this, and this is a picture of Harold out of character with Estelle Harrison. So this is a really nice shot.
Yeah.
So, that's Harold or Gaylord?
That's Harold.
That's Harold.
That's why he looks more like Harold than Gaylord does.
Yeah. He and Gaylord do look, you know, there is a strong resemblance.
Yeah, definitely.
And Estelle Harrison.
Mm-hmm.
She's cute.
Yeah.
Yeah, and Estelle Harrison, after doing the shorts, she did a couple of Western features, but then kind of left pictures around 1923.
Mm.
So. But anyway, since Richard was so generous, I wanted to make sure we showed the pictures.
And they're really wonderful behind-the-scenes images.
Oh,
they're
amazing.
Great. They're really great.
Amazing stuff.
Yeah. So our second film is A Cure for Pokeritis with John Bunny.
Yay!
And we've gotten a number of comments when we've shown John Bunny films before, and we wanted to show this one again. It's one that's been in circulation for a long time, and it's on the National Film Registry. So we wanted to share this with you today. So Steve, you want to talk a little bit about John Bunny and A Cure for Pokeritis?
Yeah, this is probably the most famous of the John Bunny films. It certainly circulates more. It's John Bunny, and he co-stars with Flora Finch. This is from 1912, and it's directed by Lawrence Trimble. Oh, here's a Motion Picture Magazine ad for little John Bunny statuette. And believe me, I've looked for these like in antiques, you know, always hoping to find one of these. You know, drive dull care away. Have John Bunny in your home. So, but that's.
Anybody ever finds one?
Yeah. Yeah. If you have one, let us know.
Yeah. Well, it's like the Lupino Lane dolls. Yeah. You know, there's the kind of famous Lupino Lane dolls from when he did Me and My Girl, but those seem to. There's a lot more of those around than there are of these bunny statues.
Yeah.
And that again is a token of how popular Bunny was.
Mm.
You know, I mean, really, he and Max Linder were the first global comedy stars, you know, that were really known around the world. And so Bunny and Flora Finch, you know, they were a famous team. And everybody thinks Bunny was born in England, but he was actually born in Brooklyn and spent years on the stage. And it was his choice to go into movies because he felt it was the coming thing. Mm. And he kind of showed up at Vitagraph and offered his services. And the story is they weren't really sure about this large guy with a big bulby nose. And, you know, but of course, audiences loved him because he was like everybody's uncle or brother-in-law. And people recognized him. They were like somebody they knew that they saw on the street. And he worked a lot with Finch, and she was from England. She started working in England. There was a famous theatrical producer named Ben Greet, and she was part of his company, and she came to America to be a stage star. And while she was, you know, trying to get a foothold in the New York theater, she started doing movies and started working at Biograph. So she's in a number of the D.W. Griffith comedies, like the Jones Family comedies and Those Awful Hats and things like that. But then when she went to Vitagraph, that's when she got teamed with Bunny, and then they became very popular together. And that ad that Ben had up a minute ago was from a later series.
Oh, okay.
Because after, well, Bunny passed away in 1915, she stayed at Vitagraph for a while, but she did sort of, her own film company was initiated. As you see, Flora Finch Film Corporation. And there were some films made, but again, they didn't do that well. But she continued working as a character player. Most of her career was spent in the New York area. And she appeared in films, features with Johnny Hines, and she has some of the Max Fleischer made Carry of the Chorus series. And in about 1927, she went out to Hollywood and got some very good roles, like in Cat and the Canary.
And, she's wonderful in that. Yeah.
Yeah, and some other features. But when sound came in, I think some of those people that had started very early were kind of regarded unjustly as relics. And she really, after that, only does bit parts. She's the woman who's introducing the statue at the beginning of Chaplin's City Lights.
Yeah.
And she has a very nice bit in Laurel and Hardy's Way Out West.
Way Out West.
Opening. Yeah, where she's looking for her husband, and he's in there. He's flirting with what's-her-name who's doing the song, and she goes and sits on
Sharon
his lap.
Lynn,
and beats
him
up.
She's got a nice little bit in the middle.
She's got a nice bit. Yeah. She's very good, and her voice is fine because she does speak. So she worked till about 1940 doing, you know, I think her last film was The Women with Norma Shearer. She worked. And but they were probably the first comedy team, the first movie comedy team were Bunny and Finch. So I think we should go ahead and take a look.
Yeah.
There's a couple other players I want to mention afterwards. But it's a lot of fun, and it's very well directed by Lawrence Trimble, and we'll talk more about him too. So
All right. Well, this is Cure for Pokeritis, starring John Bunny, made in 1912. Brooklyn's own John Bunny. This is a film that is on the Slapstick Encyclopedia. Multi-disc set. It was originally released on VHS and I think Laser in the late 90s, and then David Shepard put it out through this another company called Mattis. It's a large multi. It's like I think it's 7 discs. You can still get copies on Amazon.
Wow!
And so we're this. You know, this is the version we're showing, and we thank Serge Bromberg and.
Merci, Serge.
Thank you, Serge Bromberg and Lobster Films, the Blackhawk Film Collection. So we are able to share this fun film with you today. So, Manu, if you get the lights.
Yes, of course.
We will watch.
John Bunny.
Here is John Bunny. And John Bunny, accompanied by me, live in our living room to you. Here is John Bunny in A Cure for Pokeritis. Yes, and that is a cure for pokeritis, and wasn't it though? it's a fun little film, and you really see
nice little situational comedy. It's a,
and you really get to see the Vitagraph style, where there's often a use of multiple planes of action, but you always know where to look. So there might be a group of people, and John Bunny's in the corner here or over here, but we're absolutely able to follow.
His
reactions and everything. Yeah. Very subtle and a lot of fun.
It's well directed. It's directed by a guy named Lawrence Trimble. Mm-hmm. And Trimble was one of the Vitagraph directors, but he got into directing because his dog, Gene, became a Vitagraph star. He was a writer in New York, and he went to the studio to write some stories. This is his story, what he said. And he had Gene with him, and he hit the story department, and there was a story editor who was really upset because they got this great story, but it needed a dog that could do certain things. Mm-hmm. And Trimble's like, well, my dog can do this. And they're like, oh, right. But they let him try, and Gene did very well.
Oh, wow.
And so they started using Gene in more of the pictures. So he was directing the dog to begin with. But then they started letting him direct the dog's pictures. And then he did a lot with Bunny. Then he just became a director, and he's a very good director.
Yeah.
This is good. There's a later film. See, he and Florence Turner kind of became a team, and he directed a lot of her films. And then in 1913, they left Vitagraph, and they went to England, and they sent up the Turner Film Company. Mm. And Gene was their logo. Gene the dog was their logo.
Oh, wow.
and they made pictures in England that he directed, features and shorts and things with Turner, and other people directed. But they made one film that survives called Daisy's Doodad Dial.
Oh my goodness. That is something a lot of people know that
yeah,
film, because
it's available
some funny visuals.
On YouTube. It's a wonderful film. He directed it, and he plays the husband in it as well. And it's an excellent, excellent film. So they were making films in England, but then the war kind of interrupted that. They were, you know, and so they had to come back to America. And then he and I think it was his second wife, Jane Murfin developed another dog star, Strongheart.
Strongheart, I've heard of. Yeah, so like an answer to Rin Tin Tin.
He directed these films in the 20s with Strongheart. So, but he was a good comedy director. He directed a lot of stuff with Bunny at Vitagraph in 1912, 1913, before he and Turner went to England.
No relation to Arthur Trimble.
Nope, no relation.
The kid who played Buster Brown. Yeah.
But there's a couple of good supporting players. The best is Harry T. Morey plays Cousin Freddy. And we've shown him on the watch party before in the Florence Turner film She Cried, where she's working in the box factory and she cries all the time. He's the tough guy that she ends up marrying at the end. Character named Red Grogan, who's this like really tough and mean. And here he's playing this effeminate, you know, Cousin Freddy, who's obviously one of the girls because he sides with the girls to trap the husbands and stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, they don't overdo it, but he is kind of effeminate. And so he's very good. I mean, he does a nice job without overdoing it.
Yeah.
And you know, his Bible class, he's teaching a Bible class, and you know, so all the, you know, the markers are there, but he's very good. And then William Dunn is the guy that's running the poker games with the dark hair. And he sneaks out the back when the cops come before. Mm. And that's Eddie Dunn's brother. Eddie Dunn was a character player in Vitagraph films. He started when he was very young. But then he's at Roach. He's in Roach in the 1930s. He also worked with Charlie Bowers in the 20s in New York. Mm. But William Dunn was his older brother, who was more of a dramatic actor, and he became something of a star for Vitagraph, playing dramatic roles. So both of them are shown to pretty good advantage. And then there's Charles Eldridge is an older man who's playing poker, and his wife, who rescues him, is Mary Maurice, who played mothers and grandmothers for Vitagraph for years.
Yeah.
So it's a really well-made little film. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah. And if you like John Bunny, want to see more John Bunny, do look up there's a DVD called John Bunny Films First King of Comedy. Mm-hmm. Our friend Tony Susnick did. It's a documentary, but also on the DVD are four John Bunny comedies in very nice 35mm prints
scored
that I scored.
By yours, truly.
Scored by me. All right. So yeah, shameless plug. But really, it's a very good documentary. Yeah. And there's some, like I said, there's more John Bunny. It's really the only really good John Bunny release that's out.
Yeah, certainly
more recent years anyway.
So we've
gotten to see a number of the John Bunny films either at the Library of Congress or at MoMA, and the more of the Vitagraph product, especially if you can see it in a good 35mm print, run at the right speed and not too fast, there's a lot of the character and charm in their performances that you can see and really appreciate. And you see that this is just before the Keystone Mania took over and this all went out the window.
So much of it is the play of emotion on Bunny's face.
Just watching his face.
He's great. And Finch is very good. She's, you know, a lot of the solo comedies that she did are very good for Vitagraph. Yeah. So she was a very good character player.
Yeah.
So it's nice. It's, you know, I wish more of these Bunny films would circulate.
Yeah. And hopefully that'll happen in the next few years. And let's move on to our last film with Will Rogers. Big Moments from Little Pictures, made at Hal Roach. So, Steve, you want to tell our friends a little bit about Big Moments from Little Pictures?
Yeah, this is from 1924, and it's part of the series of starring two reelers that Will Rogers did for the Hal Roach studio. And Will Rogers is, like, really the first Native American movie star, because he grew up in Cherokee Territory, which is now Oklahoma, but before it was a state. And he was mostly Cherokee, Irish, and Scottish.
Interesting.
And he never, you know, he didn't exactly identify himself as a Native American, but he talked about it when he was, you know, he started in show business in Wild West shows as a roper, you know, roping horses and roping whatever. And he was billed as the Cherokee Kid.
Wow.
And from there, he's doing Wild West shows, and then he gets into vaudeville, and he's doing his roping tricks, but then he started using patter, and he started just making comments on things he read in the newspaper. Mm-hmm. And that sort of took over and became the whole act, and by the time, you know, he joined the Ziegfeld Follies in 1915, he was, you know, becoming one of America's favorite humorists. And the structure of this film is him doing his Ziegfeld act. He comes out, like, acknowledges the audience, and he does some rope twirling a little bit, but it's all about him talking and you know, telling the story of these pictures. And of course, he makes fun of Valentino, he makes fun of Douglas Fairbanks, and he makes fun of a famous play and movie called Over the Hill. Here's an example.
Here's a lobby card for it. Yeah.
20s movie with Mary Carr, who I think had done it on stage. It was, the title was known as Over the Hill to the Poorhouse, and it's about an older woman who gets neglected and she ends up in the poorhouse. Yeah. And it was really well known. I mean, it was remade in 1930 with Mae Marsh playing the role. So when he kind of makes fun of it in this film, people knew it immediately.
Yeah, you know, it's a film that isn't part of the canon today the way Robin Hood or anything else is. Yeah.
And the last segment, they make fun of the Keystone Cops.
Which were already, you know, off screen for 8 or 9 years at this point, but why not?
And the funny thing is now when you see compilation films where they're using clips of what supposedly are the Keystone Cops, often it's footage from Will Rogers and Charlie Hall plays like a Charlie Chaplin character with a little mustache. It's great footage. It's very funny. And and there's a lot of in-jokes, which you can talk about afterward. I think we should go ahead and
Let's dive in.
Yeah, and we'll talk after.
All right, thanks. Thank you. This is, once again, something that is available on the Slapstick Encyclopedia. Multi-disc set, put out, produced for video originally a few decades ago by David Shepherd, and we want to thank once again.
Once again, merci
Thank you, Serge, and the Blackhawk Films Collection and Lobster Films for giving us the okay to share this with you on today's live stream show here on YouTube. Simona, if you'll get the lights.
Yes, I can't wait to see this.
This is a lot of fun. Here we go. Here is Big Moments from Little Pictures, starring Will Rogers.
Thank you.
a lot of fun.
Wonderful.
Yes, thanks. Thank you, Mona. That was Big Moments, some little pictures with Will Rogers.
Yep. And yeah. this print's a little interesting because some of the credits are wrong. Like they
the opening credits look like they're from a reissue from the 40s or something.
No, they're from uncensored movies.
Oh, okay, that's what it was. Okay.
It says Big Boy Williams, Noah yes. Young, Earl Mohan. Okay. It gives the director as Roy Clements, and that's okay. all from Uncensored Pictures, which was made earlier, where again he made fun of different movies.
So they just got either mixed up or just borrowed, yeah.
I think, yeah, they may have borrowed. But because the actual director was J.A. Howe.
Oh, okay.
And Noah Young and Earl Mohan and Gian Williams don't turn up, but Marie Lascini does.
Marie, that's right. I did see her.
She's the nursemaid with the baby carriage, and Teddy rescues the baby, which is indeed Teddy.
Senate dog. Yeah, I thought so.
Yeah, that's one of Teddy's last appearances. Because he was getting up there, but he he's great. And it's a lot of fun. I mean, you know, it's really great to see Rogers making fun of everybody.
I love the jumping. Want to see some jumping?
That's a lot of, I mean, it's, so you know, funny. Fairbanks, even before he was in movies, he was just known for leaping about the stage. And putting him into pictures was the next, what else could you do with him? Because he couldn't jump everywhere on a stage, so just let him loop all over the place in pictures.
And the merry men jumping about, too. They're having a field day with that. And Bush.
Yeah.
Then him being afraid to get out of the tree and they have to get the ladder and everything.
Yeah.
So it's a lot of fun. I mean, it's, you know, it's a very knowing spoof. It's, and, you know, you get to see kind of what his stage act was like also, the way he introduces the film. And he was famous. Like when he came out, he would take the gum off the proscenium and put it in his mouth and chew it and talk and do the rope tricks. And then when he went off, he'd take the gum out and put it on the proscenium.
Yeah, you can see how charming he was.
Ugh. Yeah, I mean, he did about 12, I think, of shorts for Hal Roach. And he often, in some of them, he plays a ranch hand. And then in others, he plays this character called Alfalfa Doolittle, who becomes a senator.
Oh, yes. Let's see if I can find there's a picture.
And they did a number of those where he's like this new senator. Yeah, here's postcard. And this is kind of his Jubilo character.
Right.
Which he played. Yeah, Rogers, he became a big in vaudeville and in the Ziegfeld Follies doing this act. And then he started making features for Samuel Goldwyn in 1917. And they're very popular. Unfortunately, a lot of them are missing. There's only three. But, you know, they did very well. And then he decided to set up his own film company. And he made some shorts like The Rope and Fool and some others. But he went bankrupt. So he was looking for work. So he took this offer from Hal Roach and did these shorts. And then he went back to the Follies and then he started making other features. So he recouped his losses pretty quickly. But that's why he was doing these shorts for Hal Roach. It's great. I was thinking, you know, I mentioned that he was Native American and he had a great statement because he didn't necessarily identify himself as that, but he said, my ancestors didn't come over on the Mayflower, but they were there to meet it when it landed. it's a great, you know, it's a typical Will Rogers, you know, kind of thing. So, so we saw Marie Moschini and Charlie Hall. It's Charlie Chaplin and the Keystone Cops and Teddy.
Who was playing Ted, Ben Turpin.
Who's playing Ben Turpin, Mona?
I don't know. I don't recognize.
I don't know.
He looked like him, but he doesn't quite as good.
And it's not George Rowe, which you think would be the obvious choice.
Yeah, and there's some of the in jokes of like Hollywood movie making is when they would do these scenes with the cars, and in the cop chases, they would soap down or they would grease
the streets.
The streets, and that shot of him running. And trying to run and slip, that's kind of an in-joke of like, I'm in the grease, I can't, you know. And also when he was as Robin Hood, he would shoot the can, it would fall from a weird angle.
Yeah.
You know, it would fall into the frame, but it was obviously like thrown by a prop
Into
guy,
the shot, yeah.
on purpose. Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
Do you,
no,
just quickly, in the scene when they're spoofing over the hill and a director enters, do we know who the guy is
I
who's
don't know
playing?
who's playing the
Or.
director. The woman, the mother, is Emma Tansey, because she played
Okay.
Charlie Chase's mother in a number of the Jimmy Jump shorts. And then the mean matron is Helen Gilmore,
Yes, that's what I thought.
you
I
know,
recognized
the
her. Yeah.
bulldog, the human
Yeah.
bulldog who's in a lot of.
Yeah.
But as
Yeah.
far as the director, I don't recognize him or the camera guys.
Yeah.
Must be somebody from the studio,
Yeah.
I'm sure.
Yeah,
It's not
maybe.
J.A. Howe, who was the
No.
real director.
Yeah. Yeah.
And Howe was a very good comedy director. I mean,
Yeah.
he started directing the Earl Montgomery Joe Rock comedies. He
Yeah.
directed a number of those, and then he ended up at Roach, and he directed a lot of Roach comedies, and then he worked a lot with Harold Lloyd. He co-directed The Kid Brother, and he directed many of these Edward Everett Horton shorts.
Yes.
And into the 30s too. So he was a real pro. So the film's a lot of fun.
Yeah,
Yeah, definitely.
it's really well made and a lot of fun. Well, that's our show. That's episode 76. Hang on, we have a couple things to let you know about. Steve, where's my button? Here we go.
Where is
So
your
it's now
button?
it's time for
Oh.
our Cabin Fever recommendation.
I love
I
your
love that
graphic.
very nice graphic created for us by Marlene Weissman. So Steve, you
Yeah.
want to talk a little bit about something you'd like to share with our friends who are watching
Yeah,
today?
this VCI Entertainment and the Mary Pickford Foundation have just put out a Blu-ray of Sparrows. And
Oh.
if you've never seen Sparrows, you should see it right away because it's one of the greatest silent films. Mary's fantastic. It's like a Grimm's fairy tale brought to life. It's just amazing. The evil character played by Gustav von Seifertitz is just amazing. And it's a very influential film. I don't think Charles Laughton could have made Night of the Hunter. Sparrows is a direct influence on Night of the Hunter, and even some of the imagery, and there's in the swamp and all kinds of stuff. So this just came out. It looks beautiful, and it's really, I think it's only going for like $20. It's a it's so I it's I highly I mean it's a, one of the great silent films. The camera work by Charles Rocher and Carl Strauss is amazing, and then they
Yeah.
would go on to do Sunrise together
Yeah.
a couple of
They were
years later.
really the two of the top directors of photography in the
And the
silent era.
direction, it's directed by William Bodine, who we've shown a number of his films, One Shot
Yeah.
Bodine. And
Yeah. We gotta stop calling him that because that's
well,
only the,
because this
his later
he's
stuff
a
is one shot.
wonderful, yeah, he's a
No, it's
wonderful
very well
director.
made.
This is
Yeah.
great. I mean, it's
Yeah.
just so it's really one of the top silent films, I think.
Yeah, it's really great. And if you don't know remember titles, but you've seen some of these, so this is the
Yeah.
one with the alligators.
And
Yeah.
Mary gives a wonderful performance, and it's her last performance playing a child.
Yes.
Which she did a lot, but this is the very last one because then she famously got her hair bobbed. You
Yeah.
see all the photos of her getting her hair cut, and then she did My Best Girl, which is her, as an adult. But
Yeah.
yeah,
And Sparrows, one of the kids in the Grimm orphanage, isn't one of the kids in the orphanage played by Speck O'Donnell?
yeah. Well, he's actually the
Ah.
bad guy's son. He's the
Right.
bad
That's
guy's
right. He's
son.
a big pain in the neck in
So he's an
that
antagonist. Yeah, he's an
to
antagonist
Mary.
for Mary and the other kids. And the other
Yeah.
kids of this group that she's protecting are kids like Billy Butts and other kids who were working kid actors. They did a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
So, and Mary works with the kids wonderfully. I mean, you can't say too much about this film. It's really
Yeah.
great.
It's a great film. I have nothing specific to recommend except for my podcast, the Silent Film Music Podcast. We're up to episode 44, and episode 45 will come out later this coming week. If you're not on my email list, point your phone at this. Or just go to silentfilmmusic.com and sign up for my emails. I send out something every single week, and you'll always know about streams or shows I'm doing or DVD projects. And the next Kickstarter, don't worry, you'll all get a chance to get in on. I'm not going to limit the next one, but that's do sign up for my emails. But that is episode 76 of the Silent Comedy Watch Party. Any closing words from you, Steve, before we send our friends out in the rest of their day or evening?
Well, yeah, I'd like to thank everybody for tuning in. I hope you had a good time and enjoyed the films. And we look forward to seeing you again live in a couple of weeks. And then in about a month, we'll have our 2-year anniversary, which is quite something when you think about it.
Yeah.
But anyway, in the meantime, thanks for tuning in. And I hope everyone's well and keep laughing. And we'll see you soon.
All right. Thank you very much, Steve. Thank you.
Bye,
bye-bye. See you soon. All right. Well, that is episode 76 of the Silent Comedy Watch Party. I'm Ben Modell, silent film accompanist, historian, and presenter. I am playing an actual acoustic piano right here
from our living room,
sharing it out into where you are. This is this and any other streams that I do are really the only live stream silent film events happening. And it's been a privilege to be able to share not just silent film and silent film comedy, but the experience of live accompaniment, where you can have live music for silent movies over at your place.
Yeah.
We've got a great, our staff, my wife, Mana Allen, over here. Thank you, Mana.
This is so fun today.
Yes, thank you,
I'm
Mana.
I'm so glad we did this.
And thank you to Steve Massa and his wife, Susan Selig, who's co-piloting the show on the other side of the park. Our associate producer, Crystal Cuddy.
Thank you, Crystal.
And graphic design by Marlene Weissman.
Woo-hoo,
and thank you. Thank you for watching, for sharing links, for telling your friends. If you've just discovered the Silent Comedy Watch Party, there's 75 other episodes up on YouTube that you can watch.
Amazing.
And like we said, we're offering the show for free for you here on YouTube. But if you want to send in something, throw something into our chapeau to support the shows, we are set up to take payments through PayPal, Patreon, Square, et cetera, et cetera. And there's information about how to do that on the Silent Comedy Watch Party website, as well as there are links in the comment section below here on YouTube. But we hope you're well, staying safe and sane.
Yes.
And we hope this program has helped give you some laughs as you get through what you're going through or about to go through this week. We will see you in 2 weeks for episode 77 of the Silent Comedy Watch Party.
February 20th.
Yeah, that's right, February 20th. So, Mike, you got the lights?
Okay.
I will send you out into the rest of whatever your day and evening is. And thank you so much for watching the Silent Comedy Watch Party, a live stream silent film show for free for you right here on YouTube. We'll see you next time. Thank you. Thanks for watching the Silent Comedy Watch Party.
Stay well, everybody. We'll see you in a couple of weeks.